Hello, students. Today, I'm going to deliver an interesting topic about the induced breeding or hypophysation in fishes. You know, induced breeding is a technique whereby ripe fish breeders are stimulated by pituitary hormone injection to breed in captivity. The stimulation promotes a timely release of sperms and eggs from ripe gonads. So, spawning in fishes induced by some artificial breeding stimuli may be called as induced breeding or hypophysation. Now let us come, what are the hormones responsible for induced breeding? The gonadotropin hormones, in short, it is known as FSH, and it is follicle stimulating hormone, and LH, it is luteinizing hormone, secreted by hypophysis influence the maturation of gonads and the spawning in fishes. Now let us come to the advantages. Point one, by inducing the fish to spawn separately in pond, the risk of fishes getting mixed with undesirable and predaceous fish spawn is overcome. Point two, collection, identification, and the establishment of nurseries at the spawning site and the transportation of fish seed require strenuous management and the manpower, affecting the income of the farm. So all these can be saved by adopting induced breeding technique at the fish farm. Third point, the spawn of desired species can be obtained in desired numbers depending upon the demand in the fish farm. Fourth point, the induced breeding technique is simple and can be easily learned even by a layman. And the fifth point, it requires no typical surgical instrument. Now let us come to the methodology. In India, the first attempt to induce fishes to spawn was made by Hamid Khan in 1937, in which he employed mammalian pituitary hormones. He succeeded in inducing ovulation of Sirina mirgala, and the Chowdhury in 1955 was the first to successfully induce isomus dendricus to breed by intraperitoneal injection of katla pituitary gland extract. For induced breeding, hypophysation is the first and the foremost step. Induced breeding requires the knowledge about location of pituitary and its dissection, preservation, storage, preparation of its suspension, dosage, and the methods of its injection, which are described below. First one is pituitary location. Now let us come where this pituitary gland is located. So this fish pituitary gland, it is a small soft body and a whitish in color. In calves, it is more or less rounded in shape. It lies on the ventral side of the brain beside the opticaizma, just below the hypothalamus. It contains gonads stimulating hormone, that is luteinizing hormone and the follicle stimulating hormone. Now, in the second point, let us come to the donor piece or source of pituitary gland. These donor pieces are those from which pituitary glands are collected. Pituitary glands should be collected from fully ripe gravid fish as the gland is most potent at the time of breeding or just before spawning. Suitable period for the collection of glands for measured calf is from May to July, when majority of fishes reach advanced stage of maturity. So, resilient or live fishes are supposed to be the best donor for the collection of pituitary glands. However, glands can also be collected from donor fishes, which are well preserved in ice or cold storage. Now, let us come to the dissection and the removal of pituitary gland. A sharp knife or hand saw is used for dissection of fish head with oblique stroke. A portion of the skull is first removed. Gray matter and the fatty substances are removed by a blunt forceps when the brain is exposed. Then the entire brain is now lit up by detaching the olfactory and the optic nerve. Then the pituitary gland is located ventrally just posterior to the optic chiasma covered by a thin membrane. When the gland is exposed, it is carefully picked up by a tweezer or forceps. Care should be taken up so their pituitary gland is not damaged. Now let us come to the preservation and the storage of pituitary gland. The glands are stored in 100% alcohol at ordinary temperature. After each 24 hours, 100% alcohol is changed for further dehydration and the defattening. The gland is wet and stored in a refrigerator. The glands may be stored inside a desiccator containing anhydrous calcium chloride. Desiccator may be kept inside a refrigerator. Extract may also be preserved in glycerin, and the composition is 3 ml extract plus 1 ml water plus 2 ml glycerin. Now let us come to the fifth point, that is preparation of gland suspension for injection. For preparing the gland for injection, dose collected from fully mature piece at the beginning of the breeding season are preserved in absolute alcohol or acetone. Just before injection, a previously wet gland are taken out and homogenized in distilled water or 0.3% saline. The suspension is then centrifuged and the supernatant liquid is taken in a syringe and injected intramuscularly on the back or base of the caudalpin. Sometimes intraperitoneal injection is given at the base of the pectoral fin. Some investigators use glycerin extract also for the gland for injection. Why we need glycerin extract other than the other extract is that glycerin extract is known to retain its potency from 10 to 60 days and is stored in sealed impulse in the refrigerator. Next, let us come to the sixth point, that is collection, rearing, and the selection of brooders. Here we have stocking. Breeders are collected during winter month and the stock at the rate of 1,000 to 2,000 kg per hectare of water. These pieces may be fed daily with artificial food like rice bran or oil cakes at the rate of 10% body weight. Artificial feeding is not needed. If natural food is present in stocking pond, the feeding is stopped one day before the administration of injection. So if we want to inject the pieces, then we have to stop the feeding of the pieces one day prior to the injection. Next, in the point B, we have determination of sex. How we can determine a piece whether it is male or female. So during the breeding season, a mature male of measure and a medium-sized calf can be easily distinguished by the roughness of dorsal surface of pectoral fin in contrast to the smooth of female, which is very smooth at dusk. So you know at the breeding season, the pectoral fin of the male is very rough when we touch the pectoral fin and it is very smooth in case of the female. The roughness appears as early as February and March and this appears when the breeding season is over. A fully live male uses milk or on slight pressure. When we press the belly of the male piece, then it will ooze milk just like the milk. And in case of the female, when we press the abdomen, it will ooze eggs and the vein will be swollen. Healthy breeders weighing 1.5 to 5 kg are always preferred. Now, let us come to the breeding technique, how this induced breeding is performed. Induced freeze breeding experiment is adopted at the onset of the monsoon when the pieces become fully ripe. Breeders are dated out from larger ponds and transferred to smaller ponds for facilitating easy capture at the time of experiment. Ripe breeders, which are male and female, are netted out and kept in hen nests within the breeding hapa. Hypodermic needles selected for the purpose of injection include a 2 ml syringe graduated to 0.1 ml division, Clinical needles number 24, 22, and 19 are used for breeders over 1 kg, 1 to 3 kg, and above 3 kg, respectively. If it is set one set, then this one set usually consists of one female and the two males. As you know, one set is made by the two males and the only one female. The females and the males are injected with the dose which I have described earlier. Both the injected males and the one female are introduced together into the breeding hapa. Now, let us come to the breeding hapa. What is breeding hapa? The breeding hapa is a rectangular box-shaped container made up of fine mesh mosquito net cloth and are closed on all sides to prevent breeders from escaping out. It can be opened only from the above by rolling the cloth while introducing the injected breeders into it. The breeding hapa are of variable sizes depending upon the weight of the breeder. It is suspended inside the water with the help of bamboo poles fixed at the post height. Above 13 to 23 centimeters of hapa should remain above the water surface, and the bottom of the hapa should not touch the muddy pond bed. Spawning occurs within the hapa. After about 2 hours of the second injection, the breeders start swimming actively, excited and restless, and try to jump out. The more active ones chase the others, pushing it with snout. The male does not allow the female to rest, and the spawning occurs within 3 to 6 hours after the second injection. When the spawning is over, the breeders are removed. The fertilized eggs are either allowed to hatch within the same hapa or transferred to deep hatching hapa with the help of the benzizal. Sometimes heavy mortality occurs due to the sudden rise of temperature and the adverse physicochemical condition of water. Clear water without algal blooms gives satisfactory result. Then we have identification of fertilization eggs. How we can identify a fertilized egg from an unfertilized egg? The fertilized eggs appear transparent, pearls-like, whereas unfertilized eggs are opaque and whitish. The fecundity rate of Indian calf is about 2 lakh per kg body weight. Now let us come to the what are the factors influencing induced breeding. Point 1, favorable climatic and hydrological condition increases the chances of successful induced breeding. Point 2, cool weather, temperature in the range of 24 to 31 degrees centigrade and the rainy periods enhance breeding. Third point, flowing water is preferred by measured calves. And the fourth point, turbidity range should be within 100 to 1000 mg per liter. And the fifth point, light drizzling following heavy rain is ideal for induced breeding. Now, let us come to the sixth point. Failures are mostly due to the incorrect choice of breeders, wrong doses of pituitary extract, and unfavorable climatic condition. Hot, sultry, or sunny days are not suitable for undertaking induced breeding. Seventh point, light is known to bring about early maturation and the spawning in pieces by the way of enhanced photoperiod. It is due to Pandey, Kay, and Agarwal in 1990. And 8th point, dissolved oxygen concentration should not be less than 5 ppm per million. So, dear students, we have discussed about the interesting topic, that is hypophysation in pieces. If you have any difficulty, you are most welcome, and you please contact in the link given below. Thank you.